Hi, I'm Bobby Halton, and we're on the road live from FDIC 2008. And I'm real happy right now to have a brief conversation with my great friend, one of my oldest friends, Dennis Compton, who's currently been named the chairman of the National Fallen Firefighters Board. And
that's
congratulations.
Correct. Thank you very much, Bobby.
God bless you for doing that. That's
appreciate
a tremendous undertaking combined with everything else I know that you're currently doing.
It's something I'm really looking forward to, though. I've been the vice chair there for a while, been on the board for a while, and it's really an honor to be selected for that.
So what's your job when you take that role? What are you responsible for?
Well, primarily responsible for policy direction with the board of directors and for the organization. We have an executive director that manages the organization day in and day out, Ron Sarnicky. But from my standpoint, it's to provide leadership to the board of directors, help that board provide policy direction to the organization, be sure that from the standpoint of fiduciary oversight, it's appropriate, and stay involved in the organization as well.
Well, that's outstanding. And a fine organization with a great mission. A lot of people don't understand what the National Firefighters stands for, and it really is a support group not only for the widows and orphans, but it's also a support group for the fire service in terms of what happens during a line of duty death. And I think that probably the families, both families, the fire families and the firefighters' families, have a lot of issues to work through when those things occur. We were just doing a catastrophic fires panel, and one of the issues we had were that the chiefs precluded two of the departments from participating just this last week.
Uh-huh.
So actually one of them today. Uh-huh. So it's an interesting issue between learning from what happened from these true tragedies, mm-hmm. and protecting ourselves in this society that's so prone to litigation.
Yeah, one of the things I like the most about being involved with the Fallen Firefighters Foundation is, for one thing, I love to represent that organization because what I'm representing is that mission. And really what we're there to do is help the families of our fallen firefighters, help the fire departments themselves who have experienced this. And then as of the last few years, as you're well aware, the last 4 years, do what we can to help work with the fire service organizations to prevent those situations from occurring to the best of our ability. And the only way that we can be successful doing that is with the help of the fire organizations.
Yeah, and I think that it's, you know, a lot of people talk about cultural change, and I think that the word culture and behavior seem to get confused. Mm-hmm. We're looking for behavioral change.
Yes, we are.
In terms of lifestyle, in terms of procedure. And it's interesting because I think now we're starting to realize that a lot of these deaths that we're seeing are not through stupidity, but they may be more technical errors on the learning curve. But the learning curve seems to have been, while fires are faster, the learning curve seems to have been elongated, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. It does. And I read your editorial this month that we're not killing firefighters.
No, we're not.
And I thought that was well said.
Thank you. But
what really I think that we all need to realize is that firefighters can lose their lives doing everything right.
That's exactly right.
And that nobody goes to the fire station that day intentionally to get themselves or anyone else hurt. And I think what we try to work on, or what I hope all of us try to work on, is continuing to build in the capability of our firefighters and fire officers to make better decisions, to have better behaviors, so that those that are preventable, the ones that sometimes we contribute to, that those are the ones, if we can go after those, we would blow by that goal of 25% by 2010 and 50% by 2015.
Well, I think you raise a great point. It has to do with decision making. Fire ground deaths in large part have to do with decision making, and the decisions you make are predicated on the experience you have.
Mm-hmm.
And our experiences now, it takes a much longer time in the fire service to gain the amount of experience that we gained in the 70s and 80s today, because the fire numbers are just down. The problem is the fires they go to seem to be much more aggressive. And we were just talking about the Home Inn fire in Boston, the Chinese restaurant fire.
Mm-hmm.
Catastrophic fire, multiple void spaces, roof fire, heating duct, greased wood. Things that, you know, people say, well, you know, it was a roof fire. Well, in 2020 hindsight, yeah, that's easy to see. But the men who went in, for whatever reason, although they see the dripping tar, whatever was dripping from the ceiling coming down, didn't recognize it. It's a technical error. It's not a normative error. It wasn't a behavioral error. It was a technical error. It's just that now technical errors are happening 20 and 30 years into people's careers,
mm-hmm.
which is, that's what we have to get ahead of in terms of decision making and education. That's the real issue, in my opinion. It's not about all the social stuff. Well, in part I think it is, but the social stuff I think is we've done a good job of bringing to the fore. Now we need to really start looking at the tactical and the technical stuff, in my opinion. But I've got the technical magazine, so it's good for me to say that.
And also, I think the from a leadership standpoint,
that's right.
Is that if you look at the primary areas that are contributing factors to those fatalities, I mean, it's heart attacks, strokes, it's vehicles, it's strategy, and it's crew integrity.
Right.
And if you look at those over a wide band of those of the data from those injuries and deaths, I mean, you can see that a lot of them are occurring in those four categories.
And
the decision making part of, I think, to some extent, especially when you fold in what you said about experience, it becomes almost a psychological and emotional training issue that to be able to keep your mind in the game and be able to use the training and experiences you have had to help you in this situation. But that's hard to do when you're losing it emotionally.
We had a great conversation with Mike Campo the other day, a good fire officer out of New York City, and he said, every call I go to, I try to turn into a class. It doesn't matter what the call was. I try to find something, and he does. He doesn't try, he does.
Mm-hmm.
And every fire officer out there in America should make every call a class.
Mm-hmm.
Every day we make decisions, which lane to go into to make a turn, which street to go up. We should take that as if it was a fire emergency or a medical emergency or mm-hmm. a catastrophe, and overlay that in our mindset even when we're not on a call. Much easier to make a decision when you don't have to in simulation than it is in real practice. So mm-hmm. I think some of those programs are going to come to the fore, and I think I'm very happy to see what's happening in terms of those activities with the National Fallen Firefighters. You're still going to be active with the Congressional Fire Caucus, and I know we have Mr. Webb coming in a little bit to talk a little more about that, so that'll be good. So you're going to still stay active with that group, right?
One of the favorite things I do is work with the Congressional Fire Services. And I've been doing that a long time. I used to chair it, in fact.
Oh, okay.
And since Bill is your next guest, I'll tell you that I've been there for most of the ride. In fact, I've been there for the whole ride. And what he has brought to that organization in his tenure there has been nothing short of remarkable. He has brought the group together. We now have a very clear set of things that we're going to do each year. We're no longer trying to be all things to all people. We have more influence today than I've ever seen the fire service have. You heard that today in your main program from some people who would know.
Oh, absolutely.
And it's really a pleasure. And I would never stop being involved in that until they ask me to.
Oh, no, I enjoy going there because I know that I can affect things,
mm-hmm.
not just preach about things. I can get concrete action started. Mm-hmm. Dennis and I are working on the Advocates for Fire-Based EMS, which I think is a very important program. And I think it's very important that people understand we're not saying we want to put private EMS out of business.
No,
what we're saying is we want to highlight, we want to emphasize, we want to extend the quality service that the fire service can put out on the streets mm-hmm. into every neighborhood that we possibly can. And not at the cost of anybody else's jobs or at the exclusion right. of anyone else, including everyone, all the players. Fire engineering is very active with CDF West, which is a conference that has private, public, you know, all kinds of players. Even cops show up. We have to get shiny toys and mm-hmm. lots of pictures. But all the disciplines come together at that show, and we have a great time and ribbing each other. But the Advocates for Fire-Based EMS, a little bit about that. Where is that at right now, and where do you see that going down the road?
Well, Steve Austin and I, and you know Steve. He's from the Delaware
sure.
Fire Service, volunteer side of the service. He and I are facilitating that process. And we formed a steering committee. The steering committee is made up of five major fire organizations. It's the IFF, the IFC, the Congressional Fire Services Institute, the NFPA, and the National Volunteer Fire Council. And we have now been together for about a year. And in just a year, the medical community has produced a white paper, really talking about the history and the current status of fire-based EMS in this country. We've produced a DVD. That it can be used as an educational tool, not only outside the fire service, but even inside the fire service, as it relates to our role in EMS. We're speaking at a lot of conferences, I mean literally national conferences, including yours.
This one. Right.
I have. Matter of fact, I've used the stuff twice in the programs that I've done for you here this week, and very well received. And we're going to continue to work with congressional leaders. We're going to work with policymakers in Washington, D.C., because one of the things I think we assumed that we shouldn't have was that the people in office currently understood the role the fire service plays in EMS. And I think that what we did was we rested on some old work that we had done years ago. And what we found out was that may not be the case.
No, market,
exactly.
And market some more.
Exactly,
and
that's what we're trying to do.
That's right.
And we're not advocating, as you said, we're not advocating against anything. We're
that's
advocating
exactly right.
for fire service-based EMS systems and the advantage of having that system.
That's exactly right. Well, Dennis, I got to tell you, it's an absolute honor to have you here. We go back, gosh, forever. It's just, I didn't want to say how far back
Long
we
time.
Go.
Long
it's
time.
So good to see. It's good to see that you're still really at the helm, that you're still taking control of the things you can take control of. And I've always believed that you have a fine vision and a great sense of organization. And you manage to lead people without a cattle prod or a carrot and a stick. You tend to lead people with vision and kindness, and it's really nice to work with you, and it's great to have you here, and it's a real honor to have you teaching for us.
Yeah, I learned that from a lot of you guys. If I do it well, it's because of you all.
Well, no, right back at you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me here.
That's Dennis Compton. I'm Bobby Halton. We're on the road, and you be careful out there.